Hi, I'm Phil Steffes, and on this special episode of Behind the Wings, we're going to be checking out this B-17 Flying Fortress. This one's going to be cool.
This is part two of our series on the B-17. If you want to come along for a flight in the aircraft, go check out part one.
It's time to go Behind the Wings.
We're here with Buddy Cooksey today. Buddy, why don't you tell us a little bit about yourself and your role with Texas Raiders?
Well, Phil, I've been associated with this airplane since 1986. I have right at 1,100 hours in it.
So, Buddy, why don't you tell us a little bit about the design and development of the B-17?
During the 30s, the Army realized that they were going to have better equipment than what they had. The folks over at Martin built the first multi-engine bomber that was fairly decent for the day. But the Army knew they needed something more. And so they sent out bids. Douglas Aircraft came up with one, and I think Martin came up with one. And Boeing decided to go way overboard and go with a 4-engine airplane instead of a 2-engine airplane, carry a larger load, that sort of thing. And so Boeing, at their own expense, built the first couple of B-17s. Known as the 299, Project 299. The very first one, when it was rolled out from the factory, journalists looked at it and says, that looks like a flying fortress, hence the name. Very first one was flown to Wright-Patterson Air Force Base to demonstrate to the Army what they'd come up with. And I think on the second flight, the pilot was a military pilot. He forgot to release the flight controls. The airplane took off, stalled, and crashed.
In the official competition between the B-18 and the B-17 in 1935, the B-18 won, but only 350 B-18s were built compared to more than 12,700 B-17s. Why? Boeing made many improvements to the initial design. One of those improvements would have prevented the crash of the prototype, the pre-flight checklist. As the military needs changed, the B-17 became the better airplane by far.
So they went ahead and had Boeing build a couple of what they call the YB-17s. And as the war progressed and they were using more and more of them, they were realizing the issues that were not working well and some that were, and they were making modifications. The Army wanted something bigger and better, which was the B-29. Boeing quit building these things at just over 5,000 of them. Over the 12,000 some odd built, that was really the start of it. To get into the whole history, we would be here for hours.
Now that we know a little bit more about how the B-17 got started, Buddy's going to give us a closer look. Starting with the exterior of the aircraft, let's get a look at the wings.
These flight controls are fabric covered. Metal frames, fabric covered. Made it a lot lighter, easier to repair from battle damage. You can tell by looking at the leading edge of this aircraft, it's painted black here. Well, originally these were rubber coatings for de-icing the aircraft whenever flying through icing conditions. That was a much later and better modification of the airplane to put de-icers on it. The engines, they are Wright 1820-97s developing 1,200 horsepower whenever at sea level and what they refer to as standard temperatures. Above that, when things get kind of, air gets thin, they need a little bit more air to come from somewhere. So underneath they have what they call the turbo supercharger. It uses exhaust gases to spin a turbine, and from there it compresses the air, makes capability of sea level pressure up to about 22,000 feet to the engines. They can change the fuel flow and the mixtures as the airplane climbs and the air gets thinner. Really works well. It's a good system. Propellers made by the great people of Hamilton Standard. The originals were real narrow, and they decided the more air that they could bite, the better it would be, so they used these much wider blades. Another thing that's interesting at this point, there's no hydraulic actuating for the landing gear, flaps, or anything. It's all electric motors. 24 volt, it's a real easy deal. Anytime you lose something, they've got a crank to back it up. Coming across here, of course, this was the last big modification, which was the chin turret. And the reason being that the front of this airplane was somewhat lacking in armament during the first part of the bombing runs and stuff. They realized that if you hit it head on, your chance of survival is pretty good. So they said, well, we're going to fix that. So they put two 50 caliber machine guns here in the nose, in addition to one in each cheek. So there was some pretty good firepower coming out of the front.
Looks like it might add some drag. Were the earlier models a little quicker?
Yes, they were. The F model was the one prior to this. And yes, it was considerably better. But yes, this added drag. The ball turret added drag. Top turret adds drag. It has slowed it down significantly.
We're here at the bomb bay. Buddy, can you tell us how much ordnance a B-17 could carry?
Normally about 6 tons. Depending on the distance and how much fuel they had, that is always a trade-off, how much fuel you had to carry versus distance and all that sort of stuff. So they could load up with a lot of 500-pounders if they were only going like 1,000 miles. If they had a really long distance, then they would have to reduce that load. One of the unique things about the B-17 and the B-24 was the SPERRY ball turret. You can see the door here on the outside. Well, what they would do, that door actually, there was not anyone in there during takeoff and landings. He would be in the radio room. When time to get in there, they would rotate this so the guns were pointed straight down. This door would be inside, and he'd be able to get in. They'd close it up, and then he would be able to operate this. He operates it with feet and hands, and the 50 caliber machine guns, both of them are sitting right there beside him, so they were loud. One of the highest survival rates of World War II air crewmen was right there in the ball turret. Everyone thinks it's the other way around, but this guy had the best survival possibilities. They particularly chose the shortest person possible, usually about 5'2", 5'3", if they could find somebody that small. Anything else, and it gets a little bit cramped in there. So we're gonna go take a look at the tail gunner's position.
Let's do it.
There is a tunnel, basically, that runs alongside the tail wheel, and he sits on what looks like a little bicycle seat. That's what he sits on. The guns themselves are twin 50 calibers. They have a long chain of bullets going back there, and very effective defensive capability with this thing. In the event that they had to bail out, you can see under here, he had his own door he could escape from if he needed to.
How much ammunition would the average gun station carry?
Usually about 200 rounds at a time. Now they had spare ammunition in, you know, in the boxes and stuff that they could bring in if they needed to. But for the most part, they felt like 200 rounds per gun. And the deal was you fire in very short bursts. You didn't just sit down on the triggers because the barrels would melt. When you think about it, something that can fire 500 rounds per minute, a 2 or 3 second burst puts a whole lot of lead way out there.
Buddy, you talked about the ball turret gun and the tail gun here. How many gun stations did this airplane have?
This airplane actually had 13 50 caliber machine guns on it, located throughout the aircraft. And they would fly in formations, then you could be able to get maybe 50 guns pointing all at one time from all the different airplanes to defend a particular quadrant.
Three planes, 9 o'clock, coming around. Keep your eye on them, bud.
Each one of them has capability of 500 rounds per minute. All those guns firing simultaneously. It was pretty good defensive firepower.
I should say so. Buddy, we saw a lot of the airplane from the outside. Can we take a look on the inside?
Sure, follow me. The airplanes came with these auxiliary power units. Just a little one cylinder, similar to a lawnmower motor. Driving a 28 volt generator. And this helped charge batteries whenever they were loading bombs and stuff like that. They could keep this thing running and provide auxiliary power to the airplane anytime they needed it. This is an oxygen bottle so that the gunner in there could have oxygen at altitude. Each one of them had their own oxygen bottles. We had auxiliary oxygen over here. If you'll notice now, looking up, you'll see cables. That's the only way that you can move flight controls is through cables. There's no hydraulic boost, nothing else. It's all push-pull cables. A lot of redundancy. You shoot this side out, this side's gonna work for you.
Is it difficult to move the flight controls?
It is pretty heavy on the flight controls, kind of like driving a truck without power steering. But also, with that big wing out there and the way the airplane is designed, it is a very stable airplane in flight, which is what you would want. What you're looking at here is an electric motor and a pulley, right? And as you can see, there's a cable here. What they did, once they were airborne, they would reel this out. It would be a long trailing antenna, that's all it is. Everything back in the day was low frequency radios. What they did to get better reception, they'd let out a long trailing antenna and then they'd bring it back in prior to the landing.
We're making our way towards the cockpit, but it looks like we found a radio room. Buddy, why don't you tell us what's going on in here?
This particular space was occupied by the radio operator. And as you can see, this space is covered with all kind of equipment. It took a lot to get this stuff to work. It's all vacuum tubes. There was no such thing as a transistor or printed circuit boards or anything. It's all wires and vacuum tubes and stuff like that. So a thunderstorm nearby would screw up all of the reception. So there was just a lot of things that had to happen. But it was state of the art in the 1940s.
So we're gonna make our way up to the cockpit now, and to do that, you have to walk through the bomb bay. The walkway is just a skinny little plank, but on either side of you are thousands of pounds of bomb. So we've made our way in forward of the bomb bay here, and it looks like we're in the flight engineer's seat. Buddy, would he also double as the top gunner?
Yes, he would. He would use the SPERRY top gun, and the unit actually came all the way down here. So that's the one thing that we have not installed, mainly for safety purposes.
Buddy, what does the flight engineer do during a flight?
Our flight engineers are busy guys. They really are. They're monitoring our hydraulic system, and that's part of it down there, but he's also taking care of our fuel, making sure our fuels are flowing correctly. He monitors what goes on up there in the engines. He's the most super knowledgeable person we've got on board that knows this airplane in and out.
So buddy, this all looks like it could be period equipment for the airplane. Is there anything that's been added that's more modern?
We've got a modern avionics system for radios and to fly in current 2022 airspace. You must have all updated equipment to fly even into here. Everything else is pretty much of the period.
So buddy, you're a pilot and you fly more modern aircraft. What are some of the quirks and differences flying an airplane that's almost 80 years old?
Believe it or not, everything is push-pull, as you saw in the cables in the back, right? So grab onto the yoke there and pull back just a little bit. And you can see it's got some sort of resistance, yeah, and some weight. Now when it's flying, it's got air loads on those flight controls as well. Now the rudder pedals, look at the size of the rudder pedals. Now there had to be a reason for that, right? Now let's talk a little bit about the engine controls here. What we have here is the prop controls. This is how we control the pitch of the propellers. We kind of flatten them out so they can turn faster whenever we're climbing and taking off and climbing. And then we can slow them down for cruise so we get better fuel economy. These are the throttles, and this is a little bit more different. They're done underhanded like this. Now notice how the hand fits that. If you go overhand, then you have to kind of twist out, so try that.
Oh yeah.
And that would be just about takeoff position. Should we be flying and have to shut an engine down, you can easily pull just one throttle and leave the rest of them alone, leave them where they were if you need to. And as you can see, you can operate them kind of asymmetrically if you're dealing with crosswinds or something. Really a unique and very well thought out throttle quadrant. Okay, the turbo superchargers were controlled by this one little box here. Say we needed extra boost for coming out of here because it's 6,000 foot elevation. We would have a setting there for it and it would give us sea level pressure at takeoff.
All right, so we got a good look at the cockpit here with all of the analog instruments and all the procedures that we would have gone through if we were flying a B-17. Now down and forward of us is the navigator bombardier section, so let's go take a look at that. All right, we started way at the tail end of this aircraft and we finally made our way up to the front, the nose of this airplane.
Buddy, why don't you tell us a little bit about what went on in this room?
Over on the left side, as you can see, there's a table here. That was a navigator's position. That's where he could put his maps and his E6B computers, his sextant and stuff like that. He would use this dome up here to shoot the stars, sun, whatever, when he was navigating. There was no GPS or VORs or anything. I mean, this is all done by where the stars are and the time of the day. And where you're sitting behind you is what is known as the Norden bomb site.
As lead bombardier, Evans's aim must be good. Every other ship in the group will drop its bombs when he drops his.
Super secret device that was created for high altitude bombing and precision bombing. It's all analog stuff. There's no magic to any of this. All analogs and stuff like that. And that was the device they used to aim the bombs. Hopefully hit within 50 yards or 100 yards or wherever they were dropping them. That switch right over there to your left, that's the toggle switch for dropping the bombs.
So we see famous pictures of possibly hundreds of B-17s in the air. How big were some of these bombing raids?
Some of these raids were over 1,000 aircraft, and they would cover the distance of in formation coming to the target, sometimes over 20, 25 miles in trail across there. Huge formations. Now, if you were a German pilot, think about, you're up here in a little single fighter and you're gonna go pack that big mess down there and all these machine guns gonna be pointed at you, able to shoot 500 rounds per minute. That was not all that easy for the enemy aircraft either.
So Buddy has taken us around this airplane on the outside and all the way through the inside. Buddy, can you wrap up for us the legacy of the B-17 and what it means to people?
At the end of the war, people did not want to think about war. Let's just get rid of this stuff. It's converted into plowshares, so to speak, swords to plowshares. So these airplanes, as well as the B-24s, B-25s, all the great equipment that was built during those times, the thousands of them, they were systematically destroyed, melted down, and the metal used for other things. So as of today, there's probably less than maybe 20 or 25 of these things around the world left, of which there's only about 9 airworthy, and currently, as far as I know, there's only 4 that fly in the whole world.
Wow, that was awesome. The B-17 has been my favorite airplane since I was a kid. It was great getting a detailed tour from Buddy. We couldn't cover everything, so if you have questions or knowledge, feel free to drop those into our comments section and we'll do our best to get to as many as we can. If you missed part one, go check it out to meet other crew members of this incredible aircraft and to go for a ride. Now that we've reached the end of our video here, thank you for subscribing if you subscribe. And if you don't subscribe, get on it. I gotta get out of here to go check out some other airplanes.